Hi friends, it's Scott Duro, and in this video I'm going to be showing you 5 tips on how to use modern commanding, which has replaced the classic commanding that you would have used the ribbon workbench to do, which is a tool that I wrote over 10 years ago now, and it's actually the only community tool that made its way into the official Microsoft training. So stick around and I'll show you what I mean. This video is kindly sponsored by Microsoft Canada. So the first tip is how to clone a record. And this is a classic use of command bars where you have a button that will just simply duplicate the current record. But more importantly, it will also duplicate child records as well. So here is a model-driven app that I've already created with a classic purchase order line item type table structure. So parent-child relationship. So I've added these in as tables, and when you add in a table to a model-driven app designer, it gives you the ability to edit a command bar. And so I'm going to select edit command bar on the purchase order. And it gives us the option to select from the different types of command bar. So main grid, main form, subgrid, associated view. Now I'm going to select main form because this is the button that allows us to clone for the record that we've currently got open. But also I'm going to go and try and open that record as well. So doing some things which actually normally you'd have had to create JavaScript. But the great thing about modern commanding is that it enables you to use powerapps and all the benefits that come from that. So once we're in the command bar editor here, you can see all of the buttons, and I'm going to go and create a new button here, new command, and I'm going to say clone, and let's go and give it an icon here. There is even a clone icon, which is great. And we've got the option to run a formula, and in that we've got run JavaScript as well. So we've got the ability to still call JavaScript as we did before, but I'm going to use formula. And this gives us the classic powerapps style formula across the top. It also gives us the ability to have a visibility rule here. And we could actually select to show this button only when a particular visibility rule. And that, again, we can create a visibility rule using powerapps. I'm going to save this particular library here. One of the things that is somewhat difficult to do is complex powerapps expressions inside this designer. So luckily what we can do is we can open up what's called the component library, because every time I create a button inside a model driven app, the first time I do it, it creates a component library. And so I'm going to click open component library. And so what this does is just opens the canvas app designer that you'll be very used to. And you can see all of the buttons that are already being created. We've got this clone button that I just created. And if we look at the top, we've got on select as an option. And I can now just start writing my powerapps expression. Now, because I'm going to copy the parent record, I need to be able to get a reference of that ID. So when you use self, we've then got self selected. So self selected gives the item that I'm currently on. If I'm on a form, it'll have item. If I'm on a grid, it'll have all items. And because I'm on a form, I'm going to use item. So if I put this little bit of powerapps in here, this is very simple. We're going to patch the purchase orders, and we're going to create a new record. So we want to be able to use the defaults for that record. And then we're going to just pick up some information from the current record. Now I'm just picking up the name and appending copy on, but you could then just pick up all the different attributes that you want to. So you don't have to clone the entire record. You could just pick and choose the fields that you want to clone. But this patch function will return a instance of the new record. Now, normally if I was using just standard powerapps, I would sort of use something like set var new record, new, and then you know, you could use that variable to then go and relate your child records. But because we're using the command bar editor here, you can't use variables or context variables. All we can use is a construct called with. And with is actually quite useful because what it allows us to do is sort of stores a temporary version of the new record. Now we can clone the child records. And inside of this, we can use the purchase order that we've just created. And of course, what we need to do now is we need to go and iterate over all of the child records of this record that we're currently selecting, and then clone those and relate them to the purchase order we've just created. But in order to do that, I need to access the data set of those child records. Now, I can come into my data set area and I would add data. If I was cloning the activities, I would select and add activities. If I was cloning work orders or whatever, I would select the table. I've already added in the purchase order line items table here, which is what we're going to be cloning. So let's put some code in here. And what this does is we are now going to patch this purchase order line items table, and we're going to iterate over all of the line items of the selected item. And this is fantastic because you can just simply navigate down to the child items. In JavaScript, you'd have to go and grab them and do another web API request, but we can just simply use this dot notation to go and access those child records. And then, of course, we can create this patch here and simply relate the purchase order of each of these new child items to the purchase order that we created in our with. And so I'm naming them as line item here. So we're picking up the product and the quantity from the line item of the parent child, and then we are relating it to the purchase order we created. So that's the script in its entirety. And after we've done that patch, we can go navigate to the new record that we just created up here, and then also do a notify as well, so that we can just give the user information that we've just loaded that new record. So if I save this and then publish it, and that's quite important, and publish this version like that, and then go back to the normal command by editor, we get this option to resume editing in the command bar here. So there we go. And if we select the clone, we've now got that new piece of expressions that we just created over in the component library. So it makes it a lot easier because this, you can't expand this little text box at the top here to edit it. Maybe that's your bonus tip is to edit it. It makes it easier in the component library. So to test, we just simply go and play, and that will publish it. And then it'll go and open up our model driven app. And you have to refresh it once you've opened it up. And then if we come down to our purchase order here, I can then go and open up a purchase order and I can click clone like this. There we go. It's copied the purchase order and it's also given it that name with copy in brackets. I could also add the confirm function as well. Go and check that out to just sort of ask the user if they are you sure you want to copy the record. But this gives you a good idea on how to do that cloning. And of course, you could clone multiple different child records. So maybe other items like, you know, connections or child activities. And you could also create new records that are not part of the clone as well. So tip two, imagine you want to show this clone record for only existing records, because it doesn't make sense to show them for new records. At the moment, it's always going to show this record. So you can see the visibility is set to show. So we need to go and change this to say show on condition of a formula. And I can put a formula in here to say only show this record if the state of the current record is not new, because this formula has to evaluate to true to show the record. So now when I save and publish that and open up a purchase order, and I'm going to go and create a new purchase order here, and notice that there is no clone button. But if I say new, let's just set this to be account AAA, a new name like that, and then save that, you can see here the clone button is now visible. So tip three, know how publishing works. This is probably one of the most misunderstood topics around commanding. People will publish and then just simply constantly refresh the page until something happens because they're not really sure when it gets published, what's actually happening, if you've got the new version or the old version of your button. Now, of course, the simplest way is to go into your button and set a tooltip, you know, so like version 1 or version 2. And every time you make a change, you can go and check that tooltip has been updated. But when I make a change, let's go and change the formula. So let's go and say purchase order copied, and I will save and publish that. Now, if I play this record, what happens now is that I will get notified when the new version is available, because what's happening is behind the scenes, that component library is being packaged up and compiled into JavaScript to run in the browser. So you can see now that has now given us that message that a new version of the app is available. And you can see that I didn't have to click refresh. I didn't have to constantly refresh. It tells me when it's available. And so that means now when I refresh this, it will be available to me when I click this button. So if I open up this existing record and click clone, it will now give me the new record. And when I run that model-driven app command bar editor, when I click play, what I also get is this little command bar checker, command checker option on the right-hand side here. And so if I select that, what this gives me is this command checker, which I can sort of look at all the different commands that are available, and those that are hidden and those that are currently available. And if I select my clone option here, and I come over to command properties, what I get here is this little expression function piece of information, and it tells me the library that's using. What's interesting is down at the bottom here, it gives me this compiled script area. And this is very, very interesting because this is the JavaScript that is actually being compiled. And if you wanted to, you could go and look at this command, this compiled JavaScript. If I press F12 and I go into my sources and I go to open file and I put in that JavaScript and then pretty print it, I can come down here and I can see the JavaScript that actually was compiled of my PowerFX. Interestingly enough, I can also see the raw PowerFX. It's just there for sort of reference purposes. It's not passed at design time. And if I wanted to, I could actually go and check that it does have the latest version of my script if I really wanted to. Effectively, if you just wait for that message to come up to say a new available and just simply refresh, you shouldn't have any problems. If there's an error during the compilation, it will tell you when you try and select that button. It will say the component library is still publishing or there was an error in your expression. Tip four then, when you're updating multiple records in a grid, it's very important to make sure that you can do it as fast as possible because the user may have selected a large number of records. I've got two buttons here, update slow and update fast. So you can kind of guess what they do, but I'm just going to show you. So here we've got our update slow functionality. And this is what you might do if you were just going to do this without thinking about what's actually going on behind the scenes. And what we're doing here is we are doing a for all and iterating over each of the rows selected. So self-selected all items. And then what we're going to do is then we patch each of those items, each of the items in the grid with a new quantity. So we're just going to set the quantity as a random between 0 and 10. But what happens here is that it actually will iterate over all of the items and it will update them individually. And then it will refresh each time it performs an update, which ends up being quite slow. So if we look at how that works, if we just select a whole load of them here, and if I click on update slow, you can see that what it's doing is it's sort of, there is a flicker going on there and it hasn't done it. And then it refreshes the grid. So actually each of those flickers of the headers is actually a separate request is happening in sequential form. So if we go over to the update fast, it's very, very similar. We've still got a patch of the purchase order line items. However, the patch is at the top level rather than inside the for all. And the reason is what's happening here is that we're passing a collection of updated records to the patch rather than a single record at a time. And what that means is that when we go into the grid and update a load of records, what will happen is if we click update fast here, you'll notice that what will happen is it will just update them all in one batch, and then you see that the grid is refreshed. And that happens because all of those updates are happening in parallel. And you can actually see that going on. So if we go over into the network tab here and we just simply clear this down and select a whole load, and then we simply, if we say update fast, you can see they're all happening almost parallel with each other. Whereas if we close this and select a load of them this time and say update slow, you'll see that they are happening sort of much more sequentially. So my last tip for this video, tip number five, is a topic that generally people don't like dealing with, myself included, which is error handling. And so what we've got here is a script which is going to update the quantity of line items, and it's going to set an amount to be a random quantity between minus 1 and 10. Now, because the quantity can only be 0 or higher, anytime it tries to set a quantity to be minus 1, that's going to fail. We're using a very similar technique where we're doing a patch of the purchase order line items, and we've got the for all inside that patch to patch the collection. But what we're doing is we're also going to embed it inside this if error function. And what this if error function does is, if this particular function causes an error to occur, then it will return the second piece of information. So you can see here we're returning information about the number of rows and also the first error message. But if everything is fine, it will return just the value that's after this original patch here. So we've got zero errors and the message is nothing. So what we're doing is we're storing that in a with block here. So we're storing this in a temporary variable. If you remember in the first tip, we had a temporary variable to kind of get around this issue, the fact that we couldn't use context or set. So this result now can then be used after that in a notify statement. So we can say, okay, how many errors have we got in our error result? And also, if the errors are greater than 0, then we will show the error icon rather than just the standard information icon. So let's see that in action. Here we have a set of items. I'm just going to select them all and click update quantity, and it gives me the confirm. And what we can see here is it's giving me updated 5 out of 8, because some of them it tried to update to be less than 0. And it's also giving us the first error in that errors collection. So there you have it. I hope you found that interesting and useful. The cool thing about PowerFX is that the number of lines of code you're writing is so much lower than what you have to do with JavaScript. And I'm really excited to be teaming up with Microsoft Canada on their Developer Digital Meetup Tour, talking about something quite similar, which is on how you can use the Power Platform low code techniques to make your development of applications much quicker and augment your more traditional software development techniques. It's on April the 25th from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. Eastern time, and you can catch it live or it'll be on demand later on. And if you'd like to learn more, there's a link in the description below. And actually, I will be doing some live Q&A as well. And you can ask me whatever question you like. I may not be able to answer it, in which case I'll probably say I'll get back to you on that. But it would be really great to see you there. But until next time, friends, thanks for watching. Cheers.